drama. I would use my symbol. If I were a writer, I would use a pencil. I would use my voice if I were a singer. Ooh, no matter who or what we are, we must praise. If I was a doctor, I would use my research. A prolific dissertation. If I was a speaker, I would use my hands. If I were a potter, no matter who or what we are, we must praise. Oh, people of the Lord. If I were an eagle, I would use my wings. Ooh, since I'm a believer, I use everything.
Come on, real big.
Make a joyful noise
unto the Lord, all ye people. Ooh, oh, oh, yeah. No matter.
Thank you for what you've done, God. What you're doing, God. And what you're gonna do. No matter who or what we are, we must praise.
Good evening, Greater Second. Another blessed day to yet be in the land of the living. God has been so good to us. This is the end of the month of July. 7 months of 2024 has come to an end. And we're just grateful that July was not as hot as it could have been, for we got cooled off a little bit. We got August to face. So let's be careful, be proudful, drink much water, and let's get ready for this other month in Arkansas where we will see high temperatures. In the midst of all that's going on the outside, on the inside, our spirit, our soul ought to be saying, thank you, Jesus. This is another day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Let me, as we begin this Wednesday night Bible study, let me give you our sick and shut in and our bereaved list that we might pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ as a part of Greater Second Baptist. We will have three homegoing services this week. Brother Carl Hines, the uncle of Reba Luttrell, will be Friday at 11 a.m. at the St. Mark Baptist Church. And then Saturday at 11 a.m. here at the Greater Second Baptist Church, we will be funeralizing Brother Eberdeen Jones, Bunny Jones' husband. That will be 11 o'clock here at the Greater Second Baptist Church. And then 2 o'clock Saturday, the homegoing services for Mr. Floyd Jones, which is Sametta Harris Nelson's brother. And these three services will be going on this week, Friday and 2 Saturday. And then on our sick list, we want to pray for Sister Jeanette Johnson, which went to UAMS Sunday during our service. She was taken by MIMS to UAMS, and we want to keep Jeanette in our prayers. And then my teacher, Deacon Carl Williams' first cousin, Sister Shirley Williams, who is at home in Sherwood, but is going to be taking chemo from home, dealing with cancer. And we just want to keep her lifted up in our prayers. Those are the only names I have, and I know there's others, and let's keep Greater Second in our prayers as we get ready to celebrate 100 years in existence as the body of Christ called the Greater Second Baptist Church. We just thank God for the longevity of Greater Second, and we want to keep her lifted up that we might be a going church for a coming Lord, that we might continue to make the main thing the main thing. Let's keep Greater Second in our prayers. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most gracious and almighty God, we bow in the mighty name of Jesus, thanking you for this another day that you have made. Help us to rejoice each day of our lives, and help us to honor you and praise you, because all of our help and all of our strength comes from you. Oh Lord, we lift up those who are bereaved. We continually pray for their faith, their comfort, and their strength. Brother, in the passing of Eberdeen Jones, Floyd Jones, and Carl Hyde, our members, Reva Luttrell, Sametta Harris Nelson, and Bunny Jones, we ask you for comfort and strength for them as they make ready to lay their loved one remain to rest. give them what they need and help them to walk by faith and not by sight. We lift up Jeanette, oh God, and asking you for strength, asking you for comfort, asking you for healing in her body. Continually strengthen her and help her to look to you and take care of Annette. And, oh God, we just thank you for those, that family, asking for your divine presence in her life. And we pray for Miss Williams. Oh God, we're praying that everything will work out at her home, that she'll be able to remain at home. That's her wish, and we're just asking you to hear and answer her prayer. Provide the help and the people that need to help her in this time of need. We'll be careful to give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. We thank you for 100 years of Greater Second Baptist. We're praying that we will use this time and this season to build the Curtis Rideout Manor. We're praying for generosity and cheerful giving during this anniversary celebration. Oh, Lord, we thank you for GSBC. May we continually give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. It's in Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Amen. All right, my church family, what a blessing it is. I've got several phone calls this week concerning Sunday morning service, the application in giving, the application, how we ought to be generous, and how we ought to be cheerful, and how generosity and cheerful giving move the church to praise God, to worship God. And I just want to encourage us that as we continually to grow in grace, that we would also grow in giving. For giving is a part of the Christian faith. Be generous and then be cheerful as we give. God will definitely help us in our generosity because he will continually give us seeds to sow as we become more cheerful and generous in our giving. That's this past Sunday. I've enjoyed chapter 8 and chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians. I pray that your spirit has been blessed from this teaching. We will continue a couple Sundays in August as we continue the road of giving. Now, for Wednesday night study, we are in Psalms. I've been staying with the book of Psalms pretty much for the summer months, and I'm going to be teaching and sharing from the 146 through the 150 numbers of Psalms as we enter into our church celebration, as we get through the month of August and headed into September. I want to teach this five Psalms as we conclude it. Tonight we're going to study 146, but let me give you some commentary as it relates to Psalm 146 through 150. These five psalms, closing out the book of Psalms, are known as the Hallelujah Chorus or the Final Hallels, a summation of praise for the entire book of Psalms. Each psalm in these chapters begins and ends with the Hebrew words, Hallelujah, or praise ye the Lord. For our reference, the word Hallelujah appears over 22 times in the book of Psalms. This frequency signifies the importance of the Hallelujah Praise. Together, chapter 146 through chapter 150, these psalms expand praise of God from the individual to the masses, from the people of Israel to all of creation. That includes Greater Second Baptist Church. What I'm motivated to do as we close this out, my spirit has been gripped, if I can use that word, to make sure that myself and the church is continually being motivated, encouraged, and excited about praising the Lord. That's just who we are. I think there's a song that said, "Praise is what I do." And I'm encouraging us from this Wednesday night studies that I am asking and declaring that we ought to be people that have no problem praising God. So through these five chapters, I'm hoping that you will find yourself, whether you are at church or at home, praising the Lord. Psalm 146 has an outline that I'm going to try to share with you, three outlines. The first covers verses 1 and 2, and it is a commitment to praise. Listen at what the psalmist says. He starts off now. Each psalm, 146 to 150, is going to start with praise the Lord, and it's going to end with praise the Lord. So let's look at verse 1 and 2. He says, "Praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord, O my soul." Commitment to praise. Praise always should start on the inside. The psalmist says, "Praise ye the Lord, O my soul." On the inside. Praise ought to start from the inside. And he says, now, "While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being." You see the commitment to praise? He said, "While I live, I will." There's the commitment, personal commitment. The psalmist, when you see "I will," he's talking about his personal commitment to praise the Lord. I am of the opinion that there is nothing ought to stop us, even aches, pains, financial dilemmas, who's in the White House, who's going to be in the White House. Nothing should stop us from praising the Lord. The psalmist says, listen to this, "While I live," which meaning as long as there's breath in my body, I have made up in my mind, I have made a personal decision that I will praise the Lord. And then he moves to a vocal praise. There's inward praise, and then there's a personal decision to praise him. He's going to do it all of his life. And then he brings up singing. "I will sing praises to my God while I have my being." He's talking about his personal commitment to praise. And then he talks about God being personal God, even though he is all of our God, he's all of our Savior. But when it gets down to personal, He is my God. He is your God, but also from a personal level, each one of us ought to have a personal relationship with God. God, through faith in Jesus Christ, did not save us in a group. He saved us individually. So God, to each one of us, ought to be personal. The commitment we have ought to be personal. And the psalmist says, my praise in him, my singing to him, will not stop as long as he allow me to live. What a blessing. What a blessing. Ongoing, if I could use that word. Praise in a Christian's life ought to be ongoing. The psalmist here talks about he gonna do it all of his life. Commitment to praise. And then verses 3 and 4, I'm going to call this misplaced trust. Misplaced trust. When we look at Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, he talks about, Solomon said, trust in the Lord with all of thy heart and lean not to thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. That's the proper trust. But let's look at how the psalmist talks about misplaced trust. Verse 3, he said, do not, okay? Make sure you watch the writing. Do not put your trust in princes, rulers, kings, princes, leaders. Do not put your trust in those who are rulers, who are leaders. They are to be reverenced. They are to be listened at. They are to be prayed for. But when it comes to trust, we are not to put our trust in man. We are not to put our life in man's hands. The Bible, what I just read, quoted, the King Solomon, he said, trust in the Lord. I have come to find out that when our trust is in people, we will find out that you can easily become discouraged. You can become crying. You can become bewildered when our trust is in man, because man can only help us so much. Man can only go so far. And so he said, nor a son of man. There we go. He's saying princes, son of man could be human being in whom there is no help. The psalmist said, don't put your trust in man, because man is not the one who you ought to look for trust. Speaking of verse 4, he said, his spirit departs. He returns to the earth. The reason we can't put our trust in man, because man is mortal. Man is going back to the dust. Man, life has an expiration date on it. He said, his spirit departs. He returns to his earth. In that very day, his plans perish or stop. When death comes, now death is not the end as it relates to our inward being, soul and spirit. Death is talking about the physical. And when our life ends, when the physical body, when the soul and spirit is separated from the body, that's death. Death in the Bible means separation. So all of us know, there's nobody listening under the sound of my voice believe that you don't have to die if the rapture does not come. If the rapture does not happen, we all got a trip with the undertaker. We all, our human remains, all of us got to go to the cemetery or the crematory. Death is just the sentence that God placed on us as a result of sin. And so the Psalms is saying, don't put your trust in man because he is mortal. He got to die too. And when he die, his plans come to an end. So make sure that our hope is in the Lord, that we don't have misplaced hope, misplaced trust. And make sure that we live our lives not looking to who's on Air Force One to bring us hope. I know we got to vote this year. I know we're in the season of the conventions, and we just come out of the Republican National Convention, and we are now headed to the Democrat National Convention. And Republican or Democrat, whoever wins the election, I'm still not putting my hope in them, even though I'm going to vote for one of the candidates. But I'm not going to put my hope and my trust. I'm not going to depend on Air Force One to bring me deliverance. I'm not going to depend on the White House. I'm not going to depend on Congress. I'm not going to depend on the Arkansas State Capitol. I'm not going to depend on the city leaders to bring me deliverance, to bring our deliverance. My trust, your trust, got to be in the Lord God Almighty. Amen. Amen. Would go there. Now we conclude this chapter, and we're going to call this outline the blessed hope. A blessed hope. Let's look at verses 5 through 10 as we come to a close. Verses 5 say, happy, or the New International Version might say, blessed. Watch this. Happy or blessed is he who has the God of Jacob for his help. Now, Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel, and God, when he refers to it as Jacob, it has the understanding that these are children of Israel, but Jacob is used because of their sinful behavior. When he calls them Israel, that's God's beloved people, the same folks, but he recognizes them now as the God of Jacob, which means that even though these people are sinful people, they still belongs to God. They are grandchildren of Abraham. You remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the patriarchs, the one that God gave the promise to of Abraham and passed it on to Isaac and then on to Jacob. And now he says, the God of Jacob for his help, which meaning that if we can put our trust in the Lord, if we can look to the Lord for our help, then he will make us happy. And it says, now whose hope is in the Lord his God. Same thing, just reminding us that if our help is in the Lord, if we're looking to the Lord for help, if we're looking to the Lord for help, then we got to put our hope in the Lord, who is Jacob's God, who is our God. We're talking about blessed hope now. Listen to him. Now he's going to give God's attributes, some of God's resume. He said, now who made heaven and earth. He's the creator. Putting our hope in him who is the creator. He made heaven and earth. Watch this. The sea and all that is in them, all that's in the sea, he is creator of that, who keeps truth forever. God is one that can be counted on. The Lord always can be trusted. He is the creator. There's nothing hidden from him. Look at verse 7. Who execute justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives freedom to the oppressed. These scriptures reminds us that those who are, and I'm just going to use the word underprivileged, poor, all of those levels that we call underprivileged, underserved, those communities, those people who are oppressed, who have been mistreated, the court system, justice have not been favorable to us. We as African Americans can relate to that in our past history. Who gives food to the hungry? There are people who are less fortunate. They would be called poor people, and they went hungry, and the war-torn countries, if we look at over in the Middle East now, and we look at Ukraine and how those countries have been bombed, and we look at what's going on in Gaza and all of the people now who are hungry as a result of being in war-torn countries. And he says, God still has not forgotten them. And then those who are incarcerated. You remember Jesus said, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. And when I was in prison, you came to visit me. And the opposite in there, when I was thirsty, you did not give me nothing to drink. When I was hungry, you did not give me nothing to eat. And when I was in prison, you didn't come to see me. So the disciples said, when were you like that, Lord? We know if we have seen you hungry, we'd have fed you. If we'd have seen you thirsty, we gave you drink. When was you in prison and we didn't come to me? He said, when you did it to the least of these, my brethren, you did it also to me. So God is a God that do not forget the underprivileged. Do not forget widows and orphans. God is a God who's going to come and see about those who are underserved, underprivileged, those who are hungry. But how he gonna do it? Most of the time he gonna do it through us. He gonna use what he has blessed us with to bless others. Always remember this, church. We are blessed to be a blessing. That's why we're teaching on Sunday morning. We've been teaching about being generous, being cheerful in our giving. We are those who must help one another. Then he goes on in verse 8. He said, the Lord opened the eyes of the blind. Look at this God, he, the creator. He gives sight to the blind. The Lord raises those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He relieves the fatherless and widows. But the way of the wicked, he turns upside down. God, regardless whether we are hungry or thirsty, if we are his people, he's going to look out for us. But then he does a contrast between those that belong to him and those who are not his, the wicked. The wicked are children of the devil. They belong to him. They have not been redeemed. They have not been saved. So the writer says, when God does look at the wicked, he's going to turn their lives upside down. The last verse concludes this. little study for tonight says the Lord shall reign forever. Reign means rule in authority. God will reign forever. Forever, your God, O Zion, to all generations. And look how he starts it. Look how he ends it. He says, praise the Lord. The hallelujah course of tonight's study begins with praise the Lord, and it ends with praise the Lord. Father in heaven, we thank you now for this study tonight. May our hearts be uplifted. May we be reminded that we ought to make a commitment to praise the Lord, that our hope should never be misplaced. We ought to be able to trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not to our own understanding. In all our ways, help us to acknowledge you, that you might direct our paths. And may our hope always be in you. Oh, Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this another Bible study. Thank you for a greater second. Now we ask that the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit will rest, rule, and abide with each of us now, henceforth, and forever. We say now, amen. Greater second, God bless you this night and always is my prayer. Hope to see you Sunday morning. God bless you and God keep you is my prayer.
Bread of life sent down from glory. Many think you were on earth a holy king, a carpenter, but you are the living word. Say it now.
Bread of heaven.
Come on.
Sent down from glory.
Many things you were on earth,
a holy king, a carpenter.
Come on, Houston, you can say it one time with us.
Bread sent down from glory.
Many things. Come on, somebody say it.
Many things you were on earth.